morning to all of you.
Good morning.
Coming from the flatlands of Texas, I've been trying to catch my breath just from walking through the building. I'm sure about time I get used to it, then I'll have to turn back. We, in reading 1 Peter last night, seemed like we didn't get very far, but in a way I think we got very far. In terms of how this letter was first read by some people who heard it in their little churches in these provinces. We didn't get further than verse 6 before we found out that these readers are facing, he said, various troubles, trials, frustrations, annoyances, whatever you might want to call it. Things are not going well for them in their communities. And in writing this letter, he starts off with some theological talk, religious talk. And that talk will go down through chapter 2, verse 10. So all that we did last night and what we'll do beginning this morning is still in his theological. In chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, there will be a turning point. And everything from there on is going to be very practical, day in, day out. This is how you do that. So keep in mind this morning that he's still in his theological mindset, giving them the kind of religious ballpark that he wants to couch. He doesn't just start off saying, do this, do that, do the other. There's a reason why Christians do this and that and the other. See, if you just started off with 2:13, conduct yourselves like this, do this, do this, do this, it would be just a list. Because it is just a list. But the reasons we do things as Christians is because we follow the thinking of Jesus, who reveals to us the thinking of God. That's why we don't lie. Not because it's on a code somewhere, or because we don't steal because we'll get thrown into jail. We don't steal because Jesus gives us a way to think about life rooted in the mind of God. That's what the Holy Great One wanted. So when it says, be ye holy, for I am holy, there in the early part of this book, he's really driving home the point that all Christian decision making has a theological basis. It's God thinking. It's the way he wanted the universe to work. If people do this and that and the other, it works well. The reason it's wrong is because if you do the other, you get in trouble. If you steal, you get in trouble. You get drunk, you get in trouble. It's just not because it's against the law, it's because it's against the way God built it to work. This is his creation. He knows how it's supposed to be. So theology is a kind of a religious way of talking about what really ought to be. Be ye holy, for I am holy. Now, when people try to become holy, and those around them have trouble with that, the emerging conflict is trouble for the Christians. Okay. Now, in the commentaries, and I feel we have to take a moment to say this. There are some commentaries on 1 Peter out there that will talk about these people being persecuted by the government, that the Roman government was on their case. So we're going to take just a brief moment on that. About 50 years after this, or so, there was an official persecution of Christians in these provinces and all across the Roman Empire. It was instituted by the Emperor Trajan. We have a little bit of correspondence that has come down through the centuries from that period. There was a man who was governor of Bithynia by the name of Pliny, P-L-I-N-Y. He was the governor. And he corresponded with the emperor himself about how to handle the problem of the Christians in Bithynia. And this was somewhere around 100, 115 AD. One of the letters that he wrote indicates that he knew very little about what Christianity was all about, this emperor Pliny. But he was very busy trying to stamp it out. He wanted to get rid of Christianity in the province of Bithynia, as the emperor had dictated. So, Christianity had permeated the cities. It was out in the countryside of Bithynia. Temples to the emperor were being deserted because people were Christian. They wanted to get rid of those Christians and get the people back in the temple to the emperor. And so Pliny had a massive program of what we'll call Inquisition. Now, you may have heard about the medieval Inquisition in Spain, where they captured Christians that were supposed to be heretics, put them through all kinds of torture and whatnot, and eventually killed them. They're trying to stamp out heresy. Well, Pliny was doing that kind of thing too, but he just wanted to stamp out all Christians. So, if someone was accused of being a criminal, and he regarded Christianity as a crime, so if a Christian was brought before the government, the Inquisition was to ask them if they were Christian. They were threatened with punishment. If they called on the god Zeus or the god Mercury or the god Hermes, who called on one of the gods, pick one, you were okay. If you worshiped the, said, I honor the emperor, you know, as God's regent on earth, you were okay. And a lot of people did capitulate back to the old ways, threatened with death. They became a worshiper of Zeus, so, you know, in a second. Others, though, said that they had formerly been Christian and had given up that persuasion as much as 20 or 25 years earlier. Just putting us back close to where we are in our book of 1 Peter. So, from that little document, we know that some people in the time of the letter of 1 Peter, were gravitating back to the old ways. The emperor replied to Pliny and said that the Christian confession of the Christian faith was an abominable crime for which severe punishment should be administered. But it was always to be allowed that if any one of these Christians denied his faith in Christ and invoked the gods, then he could live and would be a normal citizen. So the deal was not to just go kill people. It was to try to get people back to worshiping the emperor. It's only if they wouldn't do that that they lost their lives. And so it was from that correspondence we know that there was an official persecution somewhere around the turn of that century. And that was a good bit further on down the road from where we are in our book of 1 Peter. And I felt it important to say that this morning because of the commentaries out there who interpret 1 Peter in terms of an official persecution. So just to underscore what I said last night, there is no evidence of an official persecution against Christians in any of these provinces during the time of 1 Peter. Whatever this annoyance is that Christians are facing is something local. Their neighbors are vilifying them for different reasons. Christians are just looked down upon and harassed and whatnot for whatever reasons. Now, I want to say one other thing before we get into the text this morning about these provinces. Now, you notice from the opening verses that the southern part was not mentioned. Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia provide a kind of a little circular tour. And it was a fairly common thing in B.C. 14. Herod the Great, down in Israel, Judea, Herod the Great and his good friend Marcus Agrippa actually are recorded as having taken a boat up. They got off at Pontus and they made that same tour. It was almost like common tours that we might take today. I mean, chances are, if you're going down to the Galveston to get on a boat, you're going to go to what? You're going to go to Cozumel and Caymans, and you're going to do the tour. Well, it's almost like this was the tour. Just a little bit more about those. Pontus, that I mentioned up to the north, was populated by the Greeks, I said last night, as much as 700 years earlier than this. So we have nice buildings, we have educated people, we have a very flourishing commerce. The northern part up here is a very active, up-to-date, modern way of living. Inland a bit, in any of these provinces, you have very backward, illiterate, relatively poor, and comfortably so. They don't want to head anywhere. They're just a bunch of backward people, more on the interior. Now, these people in Pontus and Bithynia fought a number of wars against the Romans in those years before Christ, because the Romans wanted this, they just couldn't take it. And it was only in the first century B.C. that these provinces became Roman. But once the Romans conquered it, they sort of left them to do their own thing. They wanted the taxes from these people, but they kept on being Greeks like they had been before. There was an ancient geographer that some of you may have heard about by the name of Strabo, who wrote the first geography of the Mediterranean world. He lived there, as did a guy named Aquila. Aquila was the first one to translate the Hebrew Old Testament into Greek, so that these people had the Greek Bible, the Old Testament Bible, in Greek from way on back there. Now let's go to Galatia, which is just to the east there. Galatia is a very different place. It is populated by a bunch of people who came in there 300 years before Christ from southern Spain. Now, there is a place on your map today in southern France, called Gaul, G-A-U-L. Okay. That's a more modern name. The ancient name for that was Galatia. And these people were wild, unprincipled, and they were driven out as a bunch of bad dudes. They were driven out of Gaul, and they came across southern Europe, and they landed here. They were still wild, unprincipled, whatever. They did not have temples. They had local witch doctor types who would do things like have a little bag of bones and rocks and stuff and throw that out on the ground to do an incantation, then they would read the rocks and so on. If a crow's shadow flew over, the baby would surely die. And think, you know, things like this. It's a bunch of mishmash. They had a man of letters who wrote little stories. You would know them as Aesop's fables. Aesop was their great man of letters, and he wrote little dinky stories about little things. But if you've ever read Aesop's fables, that's their big gun. Okay, that's as good as it got. The Galatians, what else can I say about it? They were very militaristic. They would fight you at the drop of a hat. They had a very simple tribal government, and they didn't want the Romans messing around with them, and the Romans called them Galatians, made them a province, and then left them completely alone. The Romans did not want the Galatians. We have a letter in the New Testament that Paul wrote to the Galatians. Is it in verse 3, right after the introduction, that he says, "You stupid Galatians"? Read your Bible. That's how the book of Galatians starts off. You know, it's almost like you hit the mule between the eyes with a big stick to get his attention. You know, but that's Galatia for you. It being militaristic, they did take over Lycaonia and down into Phrygia. So when Paul wrote to the Galatians, he mentioned some things in southern Galatia. On the Roman provinces, it was still a different matter. That was up here. But if you read in your Bible about the Lystra, Derbe, Iconium thing, that's down in Galatia, because they took that over. The one I wanted to get to is Cappadocia, over in the Far East. Very rough, very mountainous. It's the old Hittite Empire in the Old Testament. This is where the Hittites lived. It has little or no Greek influence. Now, to back up just a bit, 3 centuries years before Christ, we have Alexander the Great. He put a big army together and made a big conquering tour of the East, and got over as far as somewhere around Afghanistan. And he died up in those mountains over there. But his army was drawn by Greeks from all over, and they sort of developed a commonly spoken Greek. And as they went through these provinces, people adopted that. And that's what we mean by the Greek influence. They adopted the language. They adopted the form of government. They adopted the building style. The Greek influence just permeated over here, but for some reason, the Cappadocians didn't want it, missed it. There was no Greek influence up there. They kept their old Persian culture. Persia is modern-day Iran and Iraq. It's a very Eastern way of thinking. So here you have people on this side who basically think like Greeks, Westerners, and you have people in Cappadocia who basically think like Persians, Easterners. Two very different cultures that we have here. There were, in the 4th century AD, 3 of my favorite ancient church writers. But that's a long time after what we're talking about. You may run into the names of Basil the Great, Basil of Caesarea, and Gregory Nazianzus. These are great Christian writers of a later period, but they're all from Cappadocia, interestingly. So, in the first century, it was mostly an out-of-the-way, rural, Eastern-thinking culture. So when he writes this letter, he writes it in Greek. but to the Christians in those provinces. We're talking people who, a lot of people who do not have Greek as a first language. But this is a letter addressed to the churches in those areas. So I'm thinking probably to Greek-speaking Christians might be able to interpret and pass this message on to people in, whether it's Persian or Lyconian or whatever the dialect is, pass it on to the people, because not all of the Christians out here were Greek. Since it's written in Greek, we have to assume that there was a lot of Greek culture, but not everybody. Now, to summarize in a nutshell what we did last night, verse 6, these people are having all kinds of troubles with their faith. In verse 13, 14, and 15, get your minds squared away. Fix your hope on Jesus. As obedient children, do not live your former lifestyle, which was a very ignorant one. But in verse 15, like the Holy One who called you, you be holy in all of your conduct. Because it is written, you be holy because I am holy. Now, that was the focus of this little introduction. If I might diagram just what's happening here, we have the introduction from 1:3 down through 2:10. When we hit 2, I think it's 11 and 12, we run into something that is terribly important. And then, beginning in verse 13, we have admonitions that grow out of that. So linguistically, just the way the thing is put together, 2:11 through 12 is our key text. We want to keep that in mind. We're still in the introduction here this morning. In verse 22, since you have, in obedience to the truth, purified your souls, love one another from the heart. Now, this is coming out of that, your conduct. There are various lists of virtues in the New Testament, in the Old Testament, and in all kinds of Greek writers. But they differ a great deal. As we'll say tomorrow morning, with the list in 2 Peter, the Greek-speaking people wound up their lists with the word arete, excellence. Excellence. Well, Christians didn't really use that. They usually started off with faith and wound up with love. Now, in between, the lists in the New Testament differ all over the place. They're going to wind up at the same place. They're going to wind up with love. That was the principal Christian virtue that sort of encompassed all of the others. And it's like John said in his gospel and in 1 John. If you would be known as my disciples, you must have love. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples. Love. Now, 1 Corinthians 13, the famous love chapter that he wrote, okay, it was not written to be read at weddings. It was written because the people in Corinth were so fragmented as a church, they weren't getting along with one another. The church at Corinth was splitting at the seams. So he writes this letter for these people in 1 Corinthians 13, get it together in love. To the Ephesians, he said the same thing. He has a list of virtues there in chapter 4, but love is what's going to bring it all together. So it is that Peter here says that Christians need to have love. I was going through the Gospel of Mark not long ago, rewriting the little curriculum for the religious award that the Churches of Christ and Christian churches give to Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts. It's a little curriculum. And it had no particular focus, so I just used the Gospel of Mark and had the students read through Mark and see how it's called the Joyful Servant Award. Well, read Mark and see what Jesus did with service. And all through the Gospel of Mark, service is based on love. So different people look at things in different ways. One of the problems we have with the Mideast and Far East right now is their basic end of the list virtue is honor. You offend my honor, you die. Honor is what it's all about. But for us, love is what it's all about. If you read the Quran, forgiveness is not in there. Kindness is not in there. It's a whole different way of looking at what's important. Our way of looking at what's important, he says, through Jesus, is love. So he's trying to take these Christians' decision-making back to that. Now, love, I think I've said this to this group before, but some of you may not have heard it, so we'll go over it again. Love, to a lot of people, is intensified light. You start dating some old girl or some old boy and you really like them, and then you really like them. Okay, so really like is supposed to be love. Okay. Now what happens when you fall out of intensified like? Okay. So, no kidding. Now, do you know what you just said? The Coptic language is the language of Egypt. It's the old language that was written down in antiquity with owls and, you know, houses and that sort of thing, pictographs. Okay. Well, Coptic is that same language, but it's written in capital Greek letters. And I learned Coptic. And I'm going to teach you a little Coptic. The word for to get pregnant in Coptic is... You got it. Okay. Oh, where were we going with this? If you fall out of intensified like, what is there? So love, the way the Christian Bible presents it, is looking out for the other one's best interest. Now, if that's what it is, you and I can love one another. You may not like me. That's okay. But if we love one another, we're looking out for one another's best interests. Now, there are a lot of people who hear the Greek word agape and say that it means ta-da-da-da-da. I've heard it mean a whole bunch of stuff. But when you boil it all down, it's looking out for one another's best interests. It's that commonality. So you don't have to really like somebody. Jesus said, you know, love your neighbor. What do you do if your neighbor's dog barks all night? You know, it's drops rotten persimmons in your side of the yard and so on. What do you do with this dude? You don't have to like him. But loving means look out for his best interest. It's a positive virtue that is not based upon your emotions. Okay. Now, with the Christian virtue of love at heart, love one another fervently from the heart. Now, verse 22, that sounds like something we need to get spiritually attuned to. It does. Why did he write it to these people? Well, if your neighbors are giving you trouble, because you're a Christian, things are being said about you that are unkind, untrue, all kinds of things going on here, and you're suffering for it. What better place to start out than, okay, look out for these people's best interests? It just makes common sense, too, does it not? If someone doesn't like you, you have options. You can split and go the other direction. You can fight. You can do all kinds of stuff. But he starts out by saying, look out for their best interest. You look to one another. Among yourselves, look out for your best interests. Now, in verse 23, you have been born again, not by something perishable, but imperishable through the Word of God. Now, the Word of God could be taken as the Bible, except they didn't have a Bible at this time. It hadn't been put together. So, what does Word mean? It means the message, the concept. Would you turn with me for a moment over to 1 John? This is another little book that is so rarely read. But one of the more important books, I think, in the Bible.
Find out where that word is.
Okay, here's the same approach to living, starting verse 5. First let's go to verse 1. That which was the first John 1:1. That which was from the beginning, which we heard, which we saw with our own eyes, we beheld him and our hands touched him concerning, what does your Bible say? The word of life. Is that right? The word of life. Okay. Now, that life was made known. We saw it. And we testify and we announce to you that life eternal, which was with the Father and was made known to us. And we have seen and we have heard and we announce to you so that you may have fellowship with us. Now, what is this life? Well, there are two different words for life in Greek. More than that, but two important ones. One is the word bios. We get our word biology from it. And it means just living things. But bios also meant the good life. So he couldn't use that word because he didn't want Christians to get the idea that if you become a Christian, you will get the good life. So he used the other word, zoe, from which we get our word zoology, study of living things. And the Christians took that little word zoology and pumped it full of all kinds of Christian stuff. So here you have, concerning the word of life, zoe, the Christian way of looking at things. And that word, again, can mean at least a half dozen things. But here it means the concept. We announce to you the concept of zoe, the concept of Christian life. And that's what 1 John is all about. But it's an instance of where the word means the concept, the idea. And so many times in the Christian world, people would become Christians but not get the concept. You can be baptized, you can go to church, but miss the word. You miss the concept of what it's all about. And that's what he's talking about here in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. Concerning the living concept. And then he quotes an Old Testament text. Flesh is like grass, its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers, the flower falls off, but the word of the Lord stays forever. And word of the Lord, as I said, is not the Bible here because that didn't exist then. It hadn't been put together yet. It's the concept that God had in mind when he created what is. So, therefore, in chapter 2, putting aside all malice and guile and hypocrisy and envy and slander, just like a little baby, you start longing for the milk of the Word. the concept. We have to get the concept in mind about what godliness is really about. That's the concept we have to go for. And we go for it like a little baby looking for some milk. It's that important to us. And if you've tasted the kindness of the Lord, he says, you come to him like a living stone. Now we're talking theology here again. A living stone is it's a mixed metaphor. There's no such thing. But like in a building, we have all of these different stones that go together to build it up. He said, the church is like a building built out of living stones. Each one of us is a stone in that building. And just like a building has a cornerstone, Jesus is that cornerstone, and the rest of us relate to one another on that basis. We are like living stones, he says, built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God. Well, Christians didn't offer up sacrifices. This is Old Testament language. Just as in the Old Testament, the priests offered spiritual sacrifices, Christians are living stones in a building, interrelated to one another, and we offer up our own form of spiritual things. But that idea of being living stones means that if we're going to have a building, we don't have a pile of rocks out there. Or having independent stones scattered around the countryside. They are together. So the imagery here is that if we're going to get the concept that God has in mind, we have to understand that we are part and parcel of one another. What you do affects me. What I do affects you. And as we live in these communities with these troubles going on around here, we're not just little independent people running around. What one of us do affects the others. But we are a building, part of something. Now, this is very interesting to me because we live in a nation of individualists. I wrote an article right at the time I ended my academic career in 2004, on tribalism. Because I thought the country, the idea of a common good, had so disintegrated that every little tribe of people wanted what they want and everyone else can just take a hike. We want what we wanted, we want it now, and we don't care about y'all. And that is so out of date. Because we have further disintegrated to being a nation of little individuals. I want what I want, and I don't care what any of you all want. That individualism, which was a main part of American fabric, has become a very disastrous thing. It's a strength in that, like in World War II, our American servicemen were able to do things because they were independent. They didn't have to wait that somebody tell them what to do. Some guy who was a private from southern Georgia could all of a sudden pick up and go lead a bunch of guys and do all kinds of things. We had that American frontier independence, but we were a nation. And what we have lost is that nation. We still have that independence, but it's turned into greed, arrogance, self-centeredness. And what once was a virtue in our country has become a very deleterious thing, very, very bad thing. If these people in Asia Minor are going to do any good at all, they have to be an us. We're in this thing together. And if we are in it together, we can face it together. We can deal with it. We can encourage one another. We can do this. And that's what this living stone thing is all about. I think we have to face this together. So he goes to the Old Testament to quote some passages. I lay in Zion, which is Jerusalem, a stone, a precious cornerstone, and he who believes in him shall not be disappointed. Now that's Isaiah 28. But he adapts it to be Jesus. In Jerusalem, Zion, I put that stone Jesus, and whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. And then he goes on in verse 7. Here he's coming out of Psalm 118. The stone which the builders rejected, this one became the very cornerstone. So he's just driving in the idea that we are a building and he is that cornerstone. And in verse 8, a stone of stumbling, oh, this comes from Deuteronomy and from Isaiah, a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they're disobedient to the word. And word here being concept. They're not following the concept. And to this doom they were also appointed. But you, he says in the next verse, are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. Okay, how do you underscore the usness? Well, you are a chosen race. Well, they're not a race. They're as different as a bunch of Oriental Cappadocians and a bunch of Bithynian Greeks. They're not one race. They're all kind of, plus these wretched Galatians, you know. They're not one chosen race. They're a bunch of mongrels if ever there was one, just like we Americans are, you know, we're everything. What is this chosen race? Christian. It's not a race, but he uses it kind of metaphorically for, okay, just like they are Cappadocians, they are Persians, they are Greeks, we are Christians. It is our own race, as it were. We are a royal priesthood. Now, the priesthood differs a great deal in people's minds. It depends on your background, how you might understand that. For the past year, I have been attending a Lutheran church, which is very different for me, in the town next to where I live. They have a liturgy. I grew up in hard-nosed revivals in Arkansas. This is a liturgy. This guy wears liturgical garments. That was sinful where I grew up, okay? They have a choir, which was sinful where I grew up. This is so different from anything, but they have a pastor, he calls himself. He's a priest, okay? If you come up in that tradition, and frankly, most of the people in that little church somehow have ties to Wisconsin and Minnesota, okay? They all wear Green Bay Packer caps and whatnot, okay? Okay. If you grow up in that tradition, what does a priest mean to you? Well, it means someone who is elevated and takes care of the local church, and the pastor, as it were. What does a priest mean to you if you grew up in the backside of Arkansas like I did? Well, he's one of those guys that got it all wrong. So what is this royal priesthood? I think the imagery is just that in the Old Testament, there were priests who handled the things of God. And in the church, each of us is that. Now, frankly, when I look at you, the first word that comes to my mind is not priest. Okay? You probably would not think that is the first word for me. But he's using this one, and probably that was true of these characters. But what's important about this is that we are doing things for God. And we look at one another in that way, that you are handling the things of God. I am handling the things of God. And that's how we're going to begin approaching these troubles that we have. We're not just a bunch of people out here, woe is me. We're a building, we're a nation, we're a chosen people, we're a race of people. We're handling the things of God, a holy nation. I don't know, I haven't thought about the church as a holy nation since I read 1 Peter last. You know, we don't even use that language for us, do we? It means that we don't have the concept. If we don't use the language, we're not thinking that. But Peter says we have to begin looking at ourselves as a holy nation. I'm proud of that. I'm proud to be an American. I lived in Scotland for years. They're proud to be Scots. Could we possibly ever be that proud to be Christian? It's almost like Christianity is something for one day of the week. It's Sunday. And we identify it in terms of the style of worship. We identify it in any number of ways. But who are we? Well, I don't know. I don't think our nation particularly looks at Christianity as a holy nation. And we very well should. Okay. Go to the last one. A people for God's own possession. I don't know where we can go with that. We are a people. I just think that we read this book as a bunch of individualists in our modern world. And he's really appealing to them, if that's where they're coming from, to get this usness. And these four or five titles that he gives them are not things to put over the door, but for them to think about. This is who we are as a bunch of people. Now, that's what he says right before verse 11. Once you were not a people, you were just a bunch of individuals. But now you are the people of God. Once, no mercy. Now you've received mercy. So you are a people of God. That's how he winds up his theology section. That's his driving in the nail. It's not just some theological gobbledygook. It's his conclusion to his theology. You are a holy nation of people. And on that basis, we read verse 11 and 12. Beloved, I urge you as displaced aliens to abstain from fleshly lusts which wage war against your soul. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles, so that in whatever they slander you as evildoers, they may, on account of your good deeds, as they see them, glorify God the day of visitation. That's the key. Now, there's one word here, and after I mention this, we'll take our break. That word in verse 11, I urge you, I exhort you, I appeal to you, whatever, it reads differently in different translations. You urge? Okay. That is a special word used in Greek literature. It occurs just over 20 times in the New Testament. And wherever it occurs in Greek literature, whether it's New Testament Greek or some guy who never even thought about God, the word I urge is used the same way. It says, everything I have been telling you up to this point brings me to this. Now listen real carefully. And the urge is not, I suggest. Okay, there are four words in Greek where I'm telling you to do it. One of those would be used by the Emperor Trajan. I'm telling you, do it. Few years later when they had that persecution. There's another one that, and it's not used in the New Testament. There's another word almost that strong, but it's a little bit softer, a little softer. And it's not used in the New Testament. Then there's one that says, I urge you to do it, but it has a tone to it. It's got a little edge to it. Like Daddy says to the boy, I want you to mow the yard, boy, and I'm coming home at lunch, too. I mean, it's got a little tone to it. And then there's one that a thoughtful guy would use with his wife. Okay? It needs to be done. So, let's get it done. It's not a suggestion. It's got to be done. But you're going to put your arm around them. You know, this is a soft way of saying what the emperor would say with another word. It's got to be done. It is not a suggestion. I urge you is not an urge. It's a full-blown demand. But this word puts a softness to it, like he says to these Christian readers, okay, people, it's just got to be this way. Now, for goodness sake, let's get with it. It's a softened way to say, I urge you as what, strangers and aliens, displaced people, people who've been run out of your homeland, abstain from fleshly lusts and keep your conduct among the Gentiles excellent. Now that word excellent is one that we don't have in the list of most Christian lists. Interestingly, it occurs in 2 Peter. We'll hit that tomorrow morning. Excellence. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles so that when they speak all of this bad stuff against you, they have to deal with your good conduct. They see that you're just a really neat, good, solid person, and they have to admit that. Keep your behavior excellent. Now, from this point, we'll pick up after a break. Everything after this point is, okay, cold turkey. This is how you go about doing that. His admonitions are not theological now. They're going to pick up after break with, okay, do this, do this, do this, do this. This is how you do that. Okay? I don't know. I hear people who say they don't like theology, and frankly, it's a tough one for me to chew on too. But in a world like ours, we need some theological concept. I sort of miss... Well, I don't miss the old days of debating doctrines. I don't miss the old days of fussing over this doctrine and that doctrine and the other one. I miss the idea of doctrine. That there is a way to conceptualize what we're trying to do that roots it in God. I miss that. So maybe there's time for a holy nation to sort of find itself. Let's go find the donuts. Okay, as we said, verses 11 and 12 are the literary turning point in this book. Did we not do Ephesians here last year? Okay, now remember in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, I urge you, walk worthy of your calling. You'll remember that Ephesians chapters 1, 2, and 3 was theology. You'll remember that Ephesians chapter 4, 5, and 6 was do this, do this, do this, do this. Okay? That's just the way it does. That's the way this little work functions. So now, in verse 13, the very first thing he says, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution. The king as the one in authority, a king. Now, here, this is not the emperor. A king would be the, you know, the big cheese in one of these provinces or whatnot. Or to governors sent by him to punish evildoers and praise those who do right. The very first thing to do when things are going wrong is to praise the organizational structure of that society. People fear anything that makes the foundations crumble. If you seem to be seditious in some way against the social order, you're a bad guy. One way to get on praise those who are in charge of keeping it together. Okay? In our world right now, there's a lot going on with, say, the local policemen. A lot of my work is in South Dallas. There's a shooting in South Dallas almost every day. Police are being targeted in South Dallas. That threatens the social structure. Country that we live in. If there is a breakdown of law and order, everybody gets chaos. And that's why his very first statement here is, speak well of, get to know, work along with those who are keeping the country together, whether it's the big guy in the big house or some of these local enforcements or whatever, work with them to keep it together. Let it be known that we are for the social order. Okay. Such is the will of God that by doing right you may silence the ignorance of foolish people. Just doing right. In verse 16, act as free people, yet do not use that freedom as a covering for evil. Use it as slaves of God. So, free men, isn't that individualism we were talking about? You are an individual. But don't use that individualism as a cloak to go out and do something bad. Look at verse 17. Honor everybody. Love the brotherhood, that's the church. Respect God, honor the emperor. Now, a little verse like that, without this historical insight, could mean any number of things. But given what we have said, it makes perfect fitting sense, does it not? Honor people, respect people, love the brotherhood of the saints, respect God, give deference to the king. The emperor. There's nothing wrong with that. Now, he may be, and goodness, if we're dealing here with just before the war of 66 to 70, do you know who the emperor was? Nero. He killed his own mother. He killed some of his best friends. He turned the Roman Senate into a bunch of people who would vote wherever Nero wanted them to vote. This guy was a bad. Do you know why he killed his mother? He had a boat built for her, especially for her. They had a big party she did on that boat out in the river. He gave the signal from shore. They pulled whatever mechanism was there. The boat fell apart and so many of them drowned, it wasn't funny. His mother survived. He hired some guys to kill her. She was lying in one of those big buildings in Rome, and his statement as he was standing beside her body, I never saw her look so lovely. Honor the emperor. What's he saying here? As a boy, my father was a scoutmaster. And he was trying to teach us to respect our country, our government, and especially our flag. And the night he was talking to our troop about the flag, he used a story. I don't know whether it was true or some preacher story he heard somewhere. Story he heard somewhere. About a man who absolutely detested the President of the United States. He just could not stand that man. But they were standing beside the parade route where the president was coming by. And as the president approached, he took off his hat, put it over his heart. His son still had his hat on. He swatted the kid and said, "Take your hat off. The president is passing." You respect the government. It may be in so many ways evil, corrupt, bad, but it is our government. Now, grant, maybe things do get at some point so bad that rebellion is necessary. The foundation of our country was based on a rebellion they felt was necessary. There was a time when God Save the King no longer worked in our country. But basically, when people live in a country, they respect the office because it's important for the government to have that office. A good friend of mine, an academic in England, could not stand Margaret Thatcher. He used words for her that were very untheological. But he respected the crown. And I think that's what we're talking about here. You show respect for all people, the church, for God, and for the king. And that is his little sermonette in a nutshell when he says, "Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles." Now he gets to specific groups. Now, when I was growing up, well, maybe I was older. I went to a graduate school. Jerry and I were classmates at that school. And we had a course in Christian education. I remember a couple of things about that course, not much. One was that to have any kind of meaningful religious education, you had to put the chairs in a circle. I remember, we were taught to do that. And you had to divide up the congregation according to age levels. You had the preschoolers, the little kids, the high school, you know, the young adults, the, you know, on to the, you know, people like me. Okay, you have all of these different age groups. Early Christians and a good number of non-Christian writers divided it up like Paul did in Epistle to Titus. You have the older women teaching the younger women, and the older men teaching the younger men, and then you have the slaves. Well, basically, that's what Peter does. He starts off in verse 18 with the slaves. In chapter 3, verse 1, he'll go to the women, and in verse 7, he'll go to the men. So this is his. He wouldn't have passed our course because he didn't get the groups right, but this is the way Peter goes about it. Slaves, be submissive to your masters, showing respect. Now, not all masters in that ancient world were gentle with their slaves. But we have to read about slaves in our country differently, so we're going to take a little sidestep here. We generally think of slavery in terms of the boatloads of Africans brought across the Atlantic, landing in Savannah or Charleston Harbor and becoming the Southern black culture. Very oppressive masters, selling the daddy here and the children down the river there and beating the slaves and the slave markets in Augusta and Memphis and so on. That's what we think of as slavery. It was not that way in the first century world. There were slaves and there were free, but very often the slave was the educated one. Quite frequently, the master was not. The slave was the one who was taught to read and write. He could keep all the tally of the things that were being bought and sold. He's the one that would go down to the marketplace and do the buying and the selling because he knew how to accomplish all. But he owed his allegiance to this man, this family. Sometimes there were harsh masters. The book of Philemon deals with that in the New Testament, where the harassed slave actually left. And the master was being told, accept this one back and don't kill him. Because he had the right to, he ran away. Don't do anything to him. Okay, he's coming back as a Christian, so you accept him. Slavery in the ancient world was, it was a category of people, but it was not like the southern blacks. So get that idea out of your mind. It's not the same. In the world of the first century, sometimes people would sell themselves into slavery in the Roman Empire to a Roman master, work off the period of indebtedness, and then when they were freed, they would be Roman citizens because the master was a Roman, and when they're freed by a Roman master, they become Roman citizens. That was a quick way to get Roman citizenship. It was just a different thing. But sometimes there were injustices. And when those injustices came along, now you have reprisals. And this uppity slave who could read where the master couldn't and whatnot, they were accused of mocking their masters, ridiculing their masters. You know, I went to Harvard. You can't count to 10. You know, it's this kind of ridicule and whatnot that went on among these people. And sometimes it actually wound up being brutal. But for the most part, it was put downs. The slaves were putting down their masters like crazy, ridiculing them. Be submissive to your masters and show respect, not only to those who are good and gentle, but to those who are unreasonable. Now, unreasonable is translated different ways. Harsh is a good word, yes. Be submissive even to those who are harsh, for this is favorable. If for the sake of conscience toward God, a man bears up under sorrows when suffering unjustly. Now, there's unjust suffering going on all over everywhere. But certainly, this particular kind of suffering is one where just showing respect gets the job done. 20. What credit is there if, when you sin, you are harshly treated and you endure it with patience? But if you do what's right and suffer for it and patiently endure it, this finds favor with God. It's just an attitude toward how you approach things when somebody does you dirty. Somebody does you wrong. How do you go about that? Well, revenge is normal. You know, getting back is normal. That's the worldly way. But he just says, hey, bite your tongue. Do it right. Now think what's going to happen here. Around the community, what are people going to say when they see this harsh man mistreat this Christian slave and the Christian slave bites his tongue, smiles, and just tries to do a good job? What are they going to say? What can they say? You see, I mean, again, without this background, that might read something like, oh, well, that doesn't affect me. Hey, it affects every one of us. How do we deal with that which is unjust toward us? Yeah. You've been called for this very purpose, verse 21 says, Christ suffered for you, giving you an example to follow. How did he deal with people when they unjustly treated him? How did he do it? I'm thinking about him standing on the pavement. Remember? They put the crown of thorns on his head. They were ridiculing him and mocking him and all of this kind of stuff. And I've often thought, they didn't have a clue who they were dealing with. Because if he had come unglued, have you any idea what they would have gone through? I mean, just what he did in the temple by himself. He tore the temple stuff up, table after table after table. The guy went berserk. These guys had no idea the power they were dealing with. But he is such an example because he took it. Class. More than class. Excellence. And he gave us, 21, that's our example to follow. He committed no sin, 22 says. There was no deceit found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he did not revile in turn. While suffering, he did not threaten. He just kept entrusting himself to God. Verse 23. He bore our sins in his body on the cross that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. He's just talking about look at the cross and let that dictate how you meet unjust criticism. How you meet being mistreated. Just look at the cross. Watch what he did. Remember that old song? There's an old Frontier song about he could have called down 10,000 angels, but he didn't. He stayed there for you and me. We don't sing that song anymore. It's not hit. I didn't like it in the first place. But the words are good. But the words are good. Think about it. He could have called 10,000 angels to take him down and deal with them, but he stayed there for you and me. That's what this verse says. You were continually straying like sheep, but now you have turned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. That's, look at Jesus. Just follow him. Now, in the same way, chapter 3, verse 1, you wives said, be submissive to your own husband. Your own husbands. So, quit the catting around. That's kind of tossed in there. Be submissive to your own husbands, so that even if any of them are not Christian, they may be won without a word being said, just by the behavior of Mama-san. The way she conducts herself. Years ago, I edited a collection of essays by different scholars in the Churches of Christ and the Christian churches. Essays on women in earliest Christianity. There were two volumes, each about that thick. About 50 different articles on different aspects of all this. One of those articles was on 1 Peter's view of women in the church. I had more letters about that one chapter than any other thing in that book. Be submissive to your own husbands, so that even if they're not Christian, they may be won by the behavior of the wives. And I had women write me letters saying, and I still have a package of them. I've tied a cord around them, and I still have them. Some of the most tear-jerking stories I have ever heard. You will not believe what my husband did to me. Let me tell you. And you want me to be submissive to that? So I realize we have some serious problems here. I'm very sympathetic to those women who would take 1 Peter, the guy who wrote 1 Peter, and pin him up against the wall. I don't know that, the previous one was, your master is mistreating you as a slave. That's harsh. It means he's beating them up. I don't know that I would stay with this. Let me tell you what a woman out in California said when I was at Pepper. She said, I was getting sicker and sicker and sicker. And we found out that he had been putting bits of radiation under the seat of my little car. Now, am I going to honor? Am I going to, you know? That's serious stuff. So I realize there are problems in dealing with this. But here's the text. And submissive can also mean deferential, show deference to. It's like with the government. Is there a time when rebellion is justified? Is there a time when no longer showing deference to a husband is justified? I think the answer would have to be yes. But on the whole, what we're saying to these slaves is, bite the bullet, be an example. Bite the bullet, be an example. How far you take that's between you and God. Maybe Peter, if you ever see him one of these days. But here's the text. Verse 2, as they observe your respectful and, what is the other word, behavior here?
Pure conduct.
Yes, your pure conduct and your behavior. Well, maybe that'll have an effect on them, like this slave's good behavior would have an effect on the master. Okay, that's 1 Peter. Verse 3, let not your adornment be external. Now, is that to be taken, period? No necklaces, no rings, no adornment. There are people who take it that way. The woman is to have no external adornment. The opposite of that is a professor that we had of Old Testament who said there are two things that need to be painted, barns and women. Remember that? I didn't say that. He did. Is there anything wrong with cosmetics? My stars, I hope not. One of these towns over here in Asia Minor was the principal getting place for cosmetics for the whole empire. Man, they made it. They were smart. One of those towns, just they had the big cosmetics factory. They had L'Oreal and all these people. Man, they had them all together right there. Okay. So let it not be only external adornment probably. Braiding the hair and wearing gold jewelry and putting on dresses. I kind of prefer, which you do, putting on dresses. But let it be the hidden person of the heart, a gentle, quiet spirit, precious in the sight of God. Now, there are people for whom, I think most of the magazines that I have seen while I've been waiting in the doctor's offices and whatnot appeal to women on the basis of this is who you are. It's what you put on and what you dial yourself up to be. There's a whole generation of little girls coming along who think that's exactly what it is. When I lived in Abilene, pulled out one afternoon to go to supper, saw smoke next block, pulled around and a house was on fire. I mean, a billion black smoke coming out of the top of the house. So I went up, knocked on the door. The door was open, went in, and there was 18 or 20 people in there having supper, did not even know the house was on fire. Okay. By the time we got those people out, and I went into the rooms to check and make sure no one was in any of the rooms, the smoke was already so low that I had to get down on my hands and knees and crawl out. It was just that quick. I got outside. And there was a little teenage girl from just across the street who was a friend of a little teenage girl that was in that house. And she said, oh, I'm so sorry for her because she lost all of her cosmetics. Yeah? I mean, isn't it true in our world that how you doll yourself up is your worth as a woman in the media? Okay. I don't think he's saying anything against doing whatever you want, but that's not who you are. Who you are is whatever's down behind those eyes. Down in there, there's a girl, and that's who you are. And I think he says, so let that come out. Let the guys see whoever's down behind those eyes. And then he says, in this way, in old times, the holy women also who hoped in God used to dress themselves up, being submissive to their own husbands. So use that word submissive again. And Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. And you have become her children if you do that. Now, in today's world, how is that heard? Well, the whole feminist movement would absolutely cringe and do its feminine thing at that point. I think irate is the best word I can think of at this point, but go bananas. Now, you have to remember, I graduated from Vanderbilt. I know those women. Okay. I know what that mindset is like. And believe me, this doesn't cohere. Now, they would go with them on, you're not wearing cosmetics and all that. They're okay with that. But this deal about the gentle and quiet spirit, that doesn't ring true to a lot of women in today's world. You've got to be brassy and in your face. And we have seen all of that. This election brought out a lot of that, didn't it? Okay. There is that mindset that's out there. And verse 6 is just not going to click. Sarah called her husband Lord. Oh, man, I want to get rid of all of that. Now, we have 4 different ways of looking at women in the church today. 2 of those are extreme. One of those would be Archie Bunker. Okay. Well, that's the best example I can come up with. Then there's one that's worse than him. But we're talking about, you know, this dominance, arrogant, rude. You know, okay, there's Archie. Okay. And on the other side over here are the radical feminists. Neither one of which, I think, have an answer to today's issues. Their answer is not any good because it's all based upon negative experiences. Any answer that they try to give is not going to solve our issues. It just doesn't work. So in the middle, there are 2 a little bit more possible solutions. One of those is a kind of a modified paternalism. It's called complementarianism. That's a great big word that means woman is a complement, not complementary, but complement. They work together, the male and female work together. But in this view, there is male leadership. Okay? They would read this verse and say, I'm okay with that. But you have books like Point Man. How do you be a responsible Christian leader of the family? They believe that a woman can be anything she wants to be in life. Doctor, lawyer, you know, candle maker, whatever she wants to be. But in the home and in the church, there's to be male leadership. Okay. Just across a very wide gap are the egalitarians. Egalitarians mean man and woman are equal in every respect. There is no male leadership. There is no female leadership. There is just pure equality. Okay. Now, a few years ago, I looked into this women in the church issue, and I thought, these people have the best arguments. So I published some books on that. Now, over the last 20 years, as I have watched people, the most successful marriages seem to be on this side, with responsible male leadership and female complementariness. They work together, each bringing something the other cannot, but they work together on this. There is an article online that lists me among the 20 top egalitarians. Simply because of those books, not because of going around speaking about it, but just because of those books that are still selling. I still think they had the best arguments. But there's a whole lot of problem making that work. So however you fall out on that, these people do not want any form of male leadership. In the home, the church, or whatever. They want it to be completely egalitarian. And these people want there to be some form of male leadership. Well, however you fall out on that, Peter fell out here. There is to be male leadership, and the female is to fit into that, and they work together. I don't see any other way to read chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. So here's a little bit of conflict in my world. I have an academic side of me, and I have a very practical, let's look at what's happening side of me. So I can't give you the answer. I'm in too much conflict with myself. Let's just read what Peter says, and that's what he says to these people. Now, whatever he might be saying to you, that's between you and him. Here's what he says to these people. You wives, be submissive or deferential, show deference to your own husbands, so that they may be won by your respectful behavior. Let it be the hidden person in your heart, the gentle, quiet spirit, and that, he says, is a matter of long standing. Now, in verse 7, in the same way, you husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way. Now, the rest of verse 7 is going to annoy the feminists to the high heavens. It will annoy them big time. She is the weaker vessel. She is a woman. Woo! I would not write that today. Talk about getting run out of town. Woo! But he did. And he's talking to the people who live over here in these provinces. He says, that's the way you do it if you want to be respected. And when, in these matters of conflict, you get your family life together, the wife has a place, the husband has a place, and here's how we go about it. That whole world was and remains today very paternalistic. It is male leadership from the get-go. Okay? In that society, how do you do it? You've got to keep in mind they had not read Germaine Greer and Betty Friedan. That shows my time. I mean, I don't even know the recent ones that have been writing on that. He's writing to a paternalistic society, and he says, here's how you do it. How you interpret that down through the centuries to your world is your business. This is how they were to solve it, given their society. Okay. Now, see, the world at that time just did not know the freedom that we have in our modern Western society. They didn't dress like us. They didn't go around doing things like us. And their marriages were not constructed like us. In the first century in Rome, there is a first thing approaching this. Women had begun to have that egalitarian mindset over here. And Juvenal says, women were so upset with men trying to be leaders in their family that one morning there were several hundred men who did not wake up. The women got together. The women got together, made a pact, and during the night, they solved the male leadership problem. That's Juvenal. He's an early writer. He wasn't a Christian. He's just saying this is how they dealt with it. Well, egalitarian just didn't work well for them. But he didn't write to Rome. He wrote to these people. And that's what he said. Now, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way as with a weaker vessel, since she is a woman, and grant her honor as a fellow heir of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. You want to talk about marriage in the Greco-Roman world? For the most part, a guy married a woman, not because he liked her or loved her, but because she was a good administrator. Her job was to take care of all of the family goings on. She was in charge of having tutors for the children. She was in charge of getting the slaves to do what they were supposed to do. She was the one who managed the household. Now, they had different words for his other relationships. There would be the one that he liked to have sex with. There would be the one that he just really liked to have coffee with. There would be whatever. They had different types of women that were in his world. Okay? That was their society. But he had a wife. And it was through that woman's children that all of the inheritance came. Her job was to provide him with a responsible household and a legacy. And whether they liked one another or not was immaterial. His other life was over here. Okay? It's that kind of a world we're talking about. It's not ours. It's not even approaching ours. Well, it may be, shouldn't it? Now, verse 8, to sum up, let everything be harmonious, sympathetic, brotherly, kind-hearted, humble in spirit, no evil for evil, no insult for insult, but giving blessings, because you were called for the very purpose that you might inherit a blessing. So, you inherit a blessing, you give blessings. That's attitudinal, is it not? Verse 8 is just attitudinal. How do you go about this? For, and here's an Old Testament text, this is from Psalm 34, let one who means to love life and see good days refrain his tongue from evil, his lips from speaking guile, and let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears listen to their prayer, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. And who is going to harm you if you prove zealous for doing what is good? Now, see, that's 1 Peter. That's what this little epistle is all about. Who's going to be upset with you if you just get your act together, and even when it's not convenient, you just do right, you do good, you honor people, you show deference. You're a really good, neat person. With that, let's take another break, and then we're going to come back and we'll finish this, but it will not take the whole hour. Let's do take another quick break, about 10 minutes or so.
Remember that tomorrow we'll be at Silver Hills, so Carol will be there with us across Timbers tomorrow morning, and bring friends, bring people, whatever, and 9:30 tomorrow morning at Silver Hills Middle School. And tomorrow morning, 2 Peter, right?
2 Peter.
2 Peter tomorrow morning. All in one fell swoop. In this.
All that's right.
All petered out.
So you're suggesting that the commentary I like needs to have a good title, right?
All right. Thank you.
Well, I did read that there was a guy who wrote a commentary on Jude not long ago that was entitled, Hey Jude. And that's true. Okay, after this very straightforward presentation about here are ways that you can meet this local intimidation that's going on by these pagan neighbors that you have, you can meet this crisis this way. And keep in mind, he said that to a group of people living 2,000 years ago in another part of the world who had other ways of going about things. So his statement is to them. Any meaning that we get from that for today's world has to be translated to our world. Okay. That's called theology. But this is an answer to their problem. Let's keep it at that level for right now and not do the theology. Let's just keep it there. Verse 13. Who is going to hurt you or harm you if you prove zealous for what's good? But even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, you're blessed. And he quotes an Old Testament text. Do not fear intimidation. Just don't be troubled. But sanctify Christ as the Lord in your hearts. And be ready to make a, does it say defense? To everyone who asks you to give an account. Well now, make a defense is not that debating thing that we were talking about. You know, give a defense does not mean to, you know, get, stand up and give a defense of what you're doing. But somebody asks you why you're doing this as a Christian, you're able to tell them. And what is there about that you're going to defend? Look at the context. Are you defending Christianity? Well, in a way, what you're defending is being a kind, responsible, gentle, honoring person. How do you explain that? Because it doesn't seem normal. Okay? You give an explanation for why you are who you are in terms of these preceding verses. Honor the emperor. Love the brotherhood. Respect God. You know? And you do that with gentleness and respect. Now, gentleness. When people are in conflict with one another, feelings rise because physiologically we become different and the way we express things becomes different. When you're around someone you don't like, you have a different tone of voice. Do you not? When a situation arises that stresses you, you have a different rapidity of speech, do you not? We had a counseling course, Jerry, by a guy who said when there is conflict, you as the counselor slow down and you converse with them in lower tones and slower speech. You just sort of de-escalate the situation. Because they're rapid firing, right? Right there in your office. You just slow it down, get it calm, and the way you go about doing it changes the whole dynamic. Theoretically. But it changes the dynamic. And isn't that what he's talking about here? These people are upset with you, they're challenging you, they're asking you what's going on and all this stuff. You be gentle, deferential, show respect. Just keep a good conscience. And that's what verse 18 has. There's a little Greek word right there that's translated and in most instances. And it would be just, really. Just keep a good conscience. In all of this. So that wherever you're slandered, whatever the reason, anybody that really rakes you over the coals will be put to shame. Because there's no reason to rake a fine, soft-spoken, well-meaning person like you. Who would do that to such a kind soul? It's better, if God should will it so, that you suffer for doing what's right than doing what's wrong. Ah, didn't he say that in 2:15? Yeah. For Christ died for your sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, put to death in the flesh, but alive in the spirit. And here's a verse I do not understand. I admit it up front. He went and made proclamation to the spirits in prison. Okay, that's what it says. I read it, I accept it, I don't know what it means. Okay? Apparently, after his death on the cross, and Ephesians 4 also has this same remark, he descended into Sheol, I think it says there. Here, he preached to the spirits in prison. Well, look at verse 6 in the following chapter. The gospel has for this purpose been preached even to those who are dead. I do not know what that means. Years ago, my alma mater, Harding College, now Harding University, asked me to speak at their lectureship on a passage in 1 Corinthians about being baptized for the dead. I found that article the other day. Looked over it again. There were about 50 different possibilities in the commentaries for what that means. And the last statement in my little lecture was, "And I do not have a clue." So here it is. It went and preached to the spirits in prison, whoever they are, who were once disobedient when the patience of God kept waiting in the days of Noah during the construction of the ark. Only 8 people came through the water. Man, that's taking it way back there, is it not? That's way back there. And corresponding to that, baptism now saves you. Not just washing off the body, but a good conscience. Now, remember what he said up there in verse 16. We want to do what we do so that we can have a good conscience. If we're clear who we are in here, we're going to be in good shape. And what is there about baptism? I don't know how often people explain baptism or how, you know, what all of the different contours are to baptism, but I'll tell you what he gets out of it. He says when you come up, you've got a clean conscience. That buried, raised to walk in newness of life, what is it you get out of baptism? Start off with a clean conscience. I've got a clean slate here, a clean sheet of paper? That's what he says. We want to be able to approach life in these provinces day in and day out with a clean slate. Nothing bad written on there. He's at the right hand of God and to heaven after the angels and authorities and powers have been subjected to him which refers to his death, burial, and resurrection. Therefore, since Christ has suffered in the flesh, you arm yourselves with that same purpose. He suffered in the flesh. You just get ready to carry that same role. He who suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for the lusts of men, but for the will of God. It's long time gone for you to have carried out the desire of the Gentiles. Sensuality and lusts and drunkenness and carousals and drinking parties and abominable idolatries. And all such things like this, they're actually surprised that you don't do all of those things. And verse 4, and they malign you. We might not use the word malign a lot in today's world. But they speak evil of you because you don't go do those things with them. They shall give account to the one who's going to judge the living and the dead. And the gospel has been preached even to those who are dead, that though they're judged in the flesh as men, they may live in the spirit according to the will of God. So you, be of sound judgment, sober in spirit or mind, for the purpose of prayer. And above all, keep strong your love for one another. Remember how he started off this section with that. Love is what binds Christians all together. Love one another because love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaint. Whatever gift you have, use it to serve one another as stewards of the grace of God. When you speak, speak as though it was God. Whoever serves, do it as though God is the one doing it. In all things, let God be glorified. Now verse 12. Don't be surprised at this fiery ordeal among you. Now that's strong language, isn't it? This is not just somebody heckling you. Fiery ordeal sounds like some people are taking it kind of bad some way. To the degree that you share the sufferings of Christ, keep on rejoicing. 14, if you're reviled for the name of Christ, be blessed. The Spirit of God rests on you. But by no means let any of you suffer as a murderer, or a thief, or an evildoer, or a troublesome meddler. Now, thief and murderer, we can go along with. But in the modern Western world, being a meddler is a way of life. How long has it been since you really heard a good old hard-knuckle sermon on gossip? probably a long time, because gossip is so much a part of the fabric of modern American life that we don't want to hear a sermon on gossip or slander, because it's so much a part of who we are. Not as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or a troublesome meddler. But if anyone suffers as a Christian, don't be ashamed. Just glorify God. The judgment is going to begin with the house of God. Look at 18. If it is with difficulty that the righteous is saved, what about the godless man and the sinner? So that those who suffer according to the will of God, just trust God to do what's right. Now, exhortations. At this point, he goes to the leaders of the local Christian community up there. Has a special message for the leaders in each one of the churches this letter is going to be read to. I exhort the elders among you, as a fellow elder. Remember, he was one of the three in the church of Jerusalem at this time. And witness of the sufferings of Christ in person, a partaker of the glory to be revealed. You shepherd the flock of God among you, not by compulsion, but voluntarily, according to the will of God. Not for gain, but with eagerness. Not lording it over people, but being examples. When the chief shepherd appears, you'll receive a crown of glory. Well, it's sort of the nature of the beast for someone who is put in a position to turn that position into a matter of authority. I see that when I travel to Central America. Any customs agent down there has got you under their control. You will pay or deal with me, or you will sit here for hour after hour. You know, I've got you. I was talking to a guy who just got out of the Marine Corps not long ago, stationed down in Kanawha Bay in Hawaii. And of course, they had to qualify on the pistol range as well. Well, he was working for an air squadron over Kanawha, and he had to wear a red shirt to signify what part of the aviation thing he did to go qualify. He just put his, they call it a blouse in the Marine Corps, but he put his khaki-colored shirt on over his red T-shirt, went over to qualify. But there was a private running the range who said, you are not dressed properly. You will have to wear a white T-shirt. And made this Master Sergeant go all the way back over to the base, put on a white T-shirt and come back so he could shoot his pistol. But he had the authority. Some people are like that when they get to be religious leaders. I am the chief. Sometimes there's a Mrs. Cheese behind him. I'm just talking out of personal experience now. This is not good. I'm just saying. But there's this matter of being the chief. Okay. And what he's saying is, hey, what you're going to do is, these people are going through the dickens. You've got to help them go through this dickens. You're to show them how it's done. Be an example to them. That's what he's calling them to do. Be an example to the flock. And then in verse 5, you younger men, you be in submission to these elders. You respect them. And all of you clothe yourselves with humility before one another, because God is opposed to the proud, gives grace to the humble. Now, when things are breaking up in a society, the younger people generally do not listen to their elders. For several years, I have done humanitarian work in the backside of Africa. There are countries made over there by the British, but underneath it all, there is tribal government that goes on. The whole continent of Africa is based on tribal government. Whatever they do at the courthouse or whatever, it's these tribal things that are the basis of how they live. And when one tribe goes after another tribe, it can get very vicious over there. So you can have the older men who know, trying to help put oil on the water and calm things down. But it's the younger men who get all excited and go berserk. And, you know. So I think there's good reason, when things are breaking apart, to admonish the younger people to just listen. Just listen. Remember when we were I don't remember who I did Titus for, but I've done some in home Bible studies down here before I started with you guys. But in Titus, he tells the older men to do da 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 da, older women to da 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 da, younger women da da. Oh, young. Guess now to the younger men, they're told one thing, just one thing: be sensible. And I used to wonder why boys only got one, all these others got a bunch of things to work on, and then I remembered being a teenage boy. And if you can get a kid, a boy, to stop and think, you might get somewhere. But if you can't get that kid just to stop and think, what are you going to do? I mean, there's no way. So if you can get an old boy to just do one thing, and that's what they've got here. You know, the kid's only got one thing. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time. Cast all of your care on him. He cares for you. Be sober. Be on the alert. Your adversary, the devil, is like a roaring lion going around trying somebody to chew up. But resist him. Firm in your faith, knowing that the same experiences of suffering are being undergone by people elsewhere in this old world. You're not the only ones. Other people are being oppressed, just like you. So you join with them and do it right. After you've suffered for a bit, the God of all grace, called you to his glory in Christ, will perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be dominion forever. Now he winds it up. I've written this through Silvanus, a faithful brother. I've written to you briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is the grace of God, so you stand in it. The one in Babylon, chosen together with you, sends you greetings. Babylon is a frequent word for the city of Rome. Chosen together with you, sends you greetings, and so does my son Mark. So greet one another with a kiss of love, and peace be to all of you who are in Christ. So it's an interesting little book. It can be read in a multitude of different ways. What we have done in this particular seminar is to try to put it against the background of the first century. Focus on the things that the book focuses on, which is the people being oppressed by their neighbors and their communities and so on, and how to go about meeting the present crisis. So we read verse after verse after verse in terms of that crisis. It is very well worth thinking what transfers and how does that transfer to our society. I think this, to wrap it up, anytime we get to a level of individualization in the church and do not see ourselves as a living stones building, we no longer have that essence that would be respected in community after community. Because for generations, churches have been the pillar of the community. Churches have been respected. Preachers have been given special deference. Pastors have special deference, and so on. That's breaking down. Along with, you can't read your Bible in the school. You can't do ta-da, ta-da, okay, as Christians anymore. There comes to be more and more, well, there comes to be less and less of that specialty that Christians have enjoyed, down level with everybody else. And there is a great movement abroad to even take the church less than that, to have less of an impact on the American scene than it does. Christendom right now is split into so many different factions that there is no such thing as unity. If we don't have unity, we will not have respect. The primary goal, I think, of Christianity in our generation is not evangelism. And if anybody sees this, I want them to hear that very clearly. I'm saying the primary goal is not evangelism if Christianity would succeed. Unity is our current goal. We have to get together if we're going to make any dent on this society. That's primary. Evangelism will come, but it will come out of unity, not out of the current fragmentation. And this idea that we just split the church and split the church and go off and start and go off and start and go off and start has got to stop. We have to find ways to be different with one another in our collegiality. Living stones in our community. And it may be that before too long, 1 Peter will have more to say about how we deal with our neighbors than we would think. Right now, we have relative peace. But who knows what fragmentation is going to bring. I'm just saying, there's a good reason that 1 Peter is in here. And it may be more important to us than we would think. So to be forewarned is good. The little book bears teaching. I was saying at the break, because the little kids in school are already facing it. You know? 1 Peter is a very contemporary book in a way. So thank you for letting me walk you through it. It's a different look, I know, but maybe it'll read a little different to you from now on, and I hope so. Thank you very much.